Hi guys, and welcome to The Truth Hurts with me, Tony Quinn. The Truth Hurts is a show about recovery and everything in between. Okay, so we are doing a new segment to the show, and it's called The Truth Behind the Scenes. Just want to say before we begin that this does come with a trigger warning. This segment, Truth Behind the Scenes, will feature some imagery or some visuals of movies where you do see drug use, and it can be very, very triggering. So if you have a problem with seeing that kind of stuff, please turn this off. And I just want to say that the intention behind this isn't to glamorize drugs or to kind of mock addiction. It's just it's a segment where we discuss how film can affect us in recovery and how film can affect us growing up and how film takes certain elements of addiction and either makes it worse than it is or less than. And it's a cool way to relate to film, to give you some idea of what it's like for addicts dealing with the way the media presents them, and just taking a look at how the media portrays addiction, and if they do it in the best way or they do it in a really bad way. So yeah, we're going to take a look at that and just have fun with it at the same time. Okay, so what we're doing now is Rhino is going to present like a film that he's chosen and a scene from a film he's chosen, and we're going to kind of unpack it, see if it kind of gets the essence of addiction or our thoughts on it and like what I think about it. And yeah, we're going to have fun with it. And just also, I love film and I studied film, so bring it, bitch. Okay, so guys, clicking play. Before I begin, I just want to say well done on this choice, because I have so much experience in being a dealer and running guns and being a drug dealer. So, really, guys, I'm joking. Oh, fuck, that's so triggering, bro. Shit. See?
You can hit pause.
Okay. They can see it, right?
Yeah.
You can keep that in. Immediately seeing this is triggering, and I can tell it's glamorizing it. Like, dude, like, fuck, I never did that, you know? I never made fucking cool padding with cat or meth.
Yeah.
And like, now I'm looking at it and I'm like,
you would never waste. First of all, you wouldn't have.
No, that's just wasteful.
And you also wouldn't have that much.
No, I mean, that much would be, yeah, you know what? I'd finish it. Like, it's just, he's wasting. Just wasting.
They're also glamorizing because they're playing that Eric Clapton song.
Fucking Eric Clapton. I mean, he glamorizes drugs.
Yeah.
He just reminds me of my dad. Eric Clapton. Dude, no. Fuck, but Jared Leto was hot before he was a cult leader, hey? Jesus. Okay. Oh, okay.
Yuri. It's my brother, Yuri.
Okay, he does get it. Fucking, I mean, he's obviously done a lot of drugs.
Crane.
Not saying allegedly.
I started with this, right? And I worked my way to the Crane. You're gonna be dead before you fucking reach
camp. Oh no! Fuck Nicolas Cage. That is not okay. Like, bro. I'm angry for Jared Leto. Like, honestly, if someone did that to me in acts of addiction, my heart would fucking break. Like, it would break. Like, I might actually go to jail. Addiction is bad. Don't do drugs.
But also, was his reaction real?
I don't know, but my reaction, like, was... let me go back. Let me see a little.
Fucking fuck! You fucking fuck! Fuck is your problem!
Yes.
And then his reaction is to go and sniff it off the carpet or wherever it is.
Dude, carpets are vibe when you want to find pieces of drugs. I would do the exact same thing here. Like, for real, I'd be so pissed off. I don't know if I'd be that fucking, like, ooh, okay, wait, I'm out of the clip now. I don't know if I would be sad, like, he kind of came off as pathetic. I think if someone did that to me, it would be a lot more anger. Mm. Like, a lot more anger. But, I mean, it's different. Like, everyone's addiction is different. But that was a fucking powerful scene. It was just very much glamorizing, like the way they show him playing with the product and like the drugs. I mean, I get it if you're wealthy and you have so much money that you don't need to worry about the next fucking fix, but I don't think that that's
how it goes down, even at the massive parties that they have.
Well, like, it might, you know, rich people parties. I've never been to one. Unfortunately, I was on the poor people drug, so I never got to play around with cocaine like that.
Okay.
That's fucking, fuck Nicolas Cage, bro. Like, honestly, fuck him.
Okay.
Yes.
So the next is from one of our favorite series. So I'm
Breaking
just
Bad. I'm getting me. Is it Jesse? Okay, it's. Oh, I love the scene, wait. I kind of remember this.
It's a rich suburbia.
Fuck, dude.
Pretty much accurate so far.
So everything about the way Jesse portrays this is accurate. They make Tom like move
and jolt and stuff.
Yeah, it's so real, and the paranoia as well. I mean, he has got real things to be paranoid about, but
the character, you mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
Not Aaron Paul.
I love Aaron Paul because of his character, dude. I love him because of this. Oh shit, bruh. The metalheads rock up to the You know, like, okay, Breaking Bad is exceptional. It is exceptional the way Jesse, what's his name, Aaron Paul, portrays that character. Okay, so in the scene, Jesse is sitting in his little house and he's looking out the window. You know, you've got soccer moms walking past and you can check the paranoia. He's kind of opening the curtain slightly, peeking out, and he takes a hit on his lolly, and the way they make time move in that moment, you know, the sounds that they use, and it staggers from one thing to the other, and that's exactly what it feels like, because on meth time doesn't make sense and everything's so fast and slow at the same time. And then comes the paranoia, which they portray perfectly. So he looks out the window, he sees like these big biker metalhead looking dudes come to the door, and he just fucking bolts, dude. Like, and it feels so real, and I like how they make the audience think that that's what's happening, and then Jesse bolts, jumps the fence, and it turns out to be two Jehovah's Witness people, little kids, coming to the door to get flyers. Like, that is what meth does. That is 100% what it does. It gives you that, maybe not so visceral, maybe not actually seeing two people come at you, you know, more like shadow people or thoughts, for me. But
in your mind, you're convinced this is happening, that narrative.
100%. I mean, I remember once thinking there were dogs coming at me. They were like shadow dogs. I didn't even get shadow people. I got shadow dogs once. But I was actually better with them. I don't know why. I was like, hey. But just in terms of Breaking Bad, I thought this was interesting. Because now I can watch it, okay? So 8 years sober, I can watch it. But it came out when I left my last rehab. And I remember I was in the halfway house, no, I was in the sober house, and I had it on my laptop, and I started watching it, and it wasn't a positive effect for me. It was a huge trigger. Like, there's a scene where Jesse takes a little bit of the meth and just schnaffs straight, and his reaction, like his immediate physical reaction to it, triggered me and made me want to use and made me want to experience what he was experiencing. So looking at it now, I don't get that, and I think that's just further down recovery, but I'm still very careful watching recovery movies, and I still haven't finished Breaking Bad, and it's like, it's weird for me to watch, but that character is science, bitch.
Okay, so the next movie, I've kind of blocked out my mind because it's had harrowing effects on me.
Oh god.
So, try and guess which movie I'm talking about.
Requiem for a Dream.
Yes. So I actually don't remember this next scene.
Did they take you to watch it at school?
No.
Dude, they did that to us. Do you know how fucked up that was? Do you remember the dildo scene?
Well, like I said, I've blocked the scenes out of my mind because it's had lasting effects and not good ones.
Okay, so there's a few scenes with the mother in the fridge. But she's going to be on a talk show that she loves and she is obsessed with, but she wants to lose weight before being on the talk show. And she goes to the doctor and the doctor gives her diet pills and she becomes properly addicted.
And with that,
let's take a look, guys. Fuck this actress's life, bro. See, even the sounds fucking keep you on edge, man. And I love the light. I love the light in this film, the colors, everything. And you see they give the halo to her head there. Yes, that bastard fridge. Jesus, still. What I really like about her character is they show the progression, but they also use metaphors to kind of explain what's going on in her head, and I really like that. I mean, she's not necessarily waking up and imagining the fridge moving like that. It's just her relationship with food, her relationship to the methamphetamine she's basically on. So it's like this constant go, 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 and fear of food at the same time. And I kind of relate to that character a lot. Like, I get her paranoia, I get her progression, I guess, why she got into it, and I get why she got hooked. And she's so delusional. And just another thing about Requiem, which I like, is at the end, it's a real consequence movie. So it's not glamorized, and it's rough. It's hard to watch, which addiction is hard to watch, and I feel like that they get that across really well. And at the end, they show each character separately, and they're all in the fetal position. And I don't know why, but that fucking gets me every single time. It's just, they want to be, you know, you want your mom, you want to feel warmth, you want to be okay, but you're not okay. And it's a tough movie to watch. I don't recommend addicts watch that movie in early recovery. It's just, it's hard, it's difficult. And we watched it in rehab. On Friday nights we'd have consequence movies, and that was one we watched, and it fucked with me, dude. And also you find like addicts in early recovery watch those movies and they kind of, I mean, you know, you're so vain in recovery. You feel like you've got, not in recovery, in addiction, that you feel like you are God and the whole world revolves around you almost. And then they look at those movies and they're like, I'm better than that. I've done worse than Jared Leto's character, you know? So it becomes a competition. Those kind of movies in early recovery can be very triggering and quite competitive.
You also get that, well, I don't know, just from my experiences of hanging out with you, you get people who go too far the other way where NA becomes like another religion almost.
Yeah.
Where it's, I find that actually quite interesting because you go too far the other way and then you become like righteous almost, or
It's very, very true. There's actually a movie called Thank You for Sharing. We should look at it regarding support groups, which I think is also very interesting. But I do find like, so, okay, early recovery, NA was my life. It was very much my life. And it's because all I was a recovering drug addict. All I was someone struggling with addiction, and it's all I knew. And I let go of all my friends and I was on my own. And the only place I had was the fellowship and the community. And it worked for me for a very long time. But I didn't want to make it my life because I'm not just an addict. I'm not just a recovering addict. And I'm not saying that the people in those meetings who continue and are very much a part of it are righteous or self-righteous or they shouldn't do it, because it obviously works for them in some way. But for me, I feel like you have to, like, I'm not saying let go, don't forget you were an addict, but you have to build a life for yourself outside of it and know you can function as a normal person in society who just happens to be a recovering addict. And then as you progress, watching these kind of movies for me becomes easier and easier. And you also become self-aware, so it's like, I'm not going to be able to sit through Breaking Bad, dude. I'm not. I can watch bits and pieces of it, but I don't think I'll be able to sit through the whole thing. And that's my boundary, you know? Films are very weird, like what's triggering for one person isn't triggering for another. But you just need to figure out what you're okay with and what you're not okay with. Okay, so what's the next one?
So we're gonna watch a clip from a movie called Thanks for Sharing.
Dude, that movie's fucking rad. Okay, well,
tell us about it.
Okay, let me watch the trailer because I haven't seen it in a while.
What's your name?
Adam, sex addict.
I have been sober for 5 years.
I have to remind myself where this disease can take me. I remembered feeling like I was gonna die if I didn't have sex.
I'm Mike, gratefully recovering. This disease is a bitch. It's like trying to quit crack while the pipe is attached to your body.
What are you doing?
Hey, I'm Neil.
You do remember why you're in this program, right?
Free bagels?
So what you making?
I'm Phoebe.
Hi, Phoebe.
I'm going on a date.
So what are we talking, male, female, shemale?
Hey, babe, you told me to get out there.
I'm losing it. Everything in this goddamn city makes me want to act out.
You think I like not having television? Blows.
Are they taking the TV out of your room? What are you, Amish?
Yes, and I was hoping to escort you to a barn raising upon my return.
I got fired yesterday over filming up my boss's skirt. I'm out of control, and I need help.
That was inspiring, yo. I'm gonna call you.
I'm gonna friggin' answer.
I'm having some really dark thoughts.
What's wrong?
The point isn't to live like a monk. Come on, you got 5 years. It's time.
Your time is our reservation.
About a half an hour.
Plenty of time.
Oh, no, our reservation.
Oh, it's fine. We still have, like, 28 minutes.
You know, if it keeps going well, you gotta tell her, right?
Is that a sobriety medallion?
I have been in recovery for 5 years.
For what? When I'm sad, I want to have sex. Or if I'm happy.
My big fear is anxiety. Whoa, hey!
Am I making you...
I love this movie. I remember getting... I don't know why I get emotional. I mean, it's about sex addiction. I'm a drug addict, but under the way that they portray the fellowship, so Sex in Lebanon and Narcotics Anonymous and all of that, they get it so right. And it's like, it's very difficult to find a film where they understand what those meetings are about and the people in those meetings and the relationship between you and your sponsor. And they nail it. And they show his genuine fear of relapsing because he knows how bad it can get. And the relationship, the complicated relationship for a sex addict, being with someone and having to have an intimate relationship and trying to navigate the addiction side and the just living with it side, which is quite similar to an eating disorder. Because it's like you can't live without food and you basically can't live without sex if you want a relationship. It's like, it's just a very interesting dynamic, and I highly recommend people watch that movie. It does something to me, like you can see now a bit. It's just because it makes me proud of the fellowship, you know. I might not be a big part of it anymore, but it's a really powerful movie, and they nail it. I hate Gwyneth Paltrow, and she's in it, but she's not so, you don't want to kill her watching her. So... It's just, it's a great movie.
You just hate the fact that you want to buy all of her products.
Goop, bro. Listen, I'm going to start an online store. It's a lifestyle store where I sell crystals that you put in your vagina. Because Gwyneth Paltrow does it and I can do it better.
What kind of crystals are we talking here? I'm just, because, you know.
Listen, it's going to have to be to theme, so it will be meh. Okay. So, like, okay, so you know we've spoken about, like, a lot of really hardcore make you think, make you see consequences movies. There's a series called, now, Don't Judge Me, okay? You know, it's one of those shit, like, TV, midday, mommy kind of sitcoms. And it's about, it's called Mom, and it's with that chick from Scary Movie, who was married to Chris Pratt, you know, that
Drew Barrymore.
Yeah, that one. That exact one. No. Okay, anyway, she was the lead actress in it. In a Scary Movie.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Scream.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about.
Yes, yeah, but she does mock her in Scary Movie. Anyway, so she's in it, and she plays a recovering addict, recovering alcoholic. And they go to NA meetings in it, and she's got a sponsor, and, like, she's a sponsor, and it's, like, really, really, really... I don't know, I just like sometimes when people can actually be humorous about recovery, which I feel is something that's lacking. And also it's like the best portrayal of NA and the relationships you form in NA that I've ever seen. So wait, I want to watch the scene, sorry.
So I met this really cute dermatologist when I was at the dermatologist. And you'll never guess what happened.
Yes, do I.
He asked me out. Now you.
Okay, see. Now, this would be the scene I choose because in the meeting they're interrupting each other and you don't interrupt each other in NA. So they're like sitting in a circle and having a conversation. But I don't think maybe this... I don't know. But let's watch. I still like it.
I'll get ready to be proud of you. Cross-talking is not allowed. I'm 4 months sober and I can't date till I have a year. Then late...
She said there... She said there, I can't date until I have a year. That is a thing that sponsors suggest in NA. See, it's shit like this that I like. That's like, it's real and you can relate to it. As an addict, this is the kind of show, as a female addict, I feel like this is the kind of show you should be watching. And you can laugh at and you can relate to it. So it's not necessarily about relating to all the bad shit you did in addiction. It's about relating to where you are now and how far you've come, which is super cool. So I suggest you watch this.
Later, he texted me and said, 233 days to go. Day after that, 232. The day after that, 231.
Wrap it up.
Anyway, looks like I'm gonna marry a dermatologist, which is as good as marrying a vampire. You never get old. Thanks.
Bonnie, alcoholic.
Hi, Bonnie.
Well, I started planning my wedding this weekend. At first, I thought it was gonna be torture, and then it hit me. This is a day all about me, planned by me, starring me.
Isn't that every day?
Maybe I always hated weddings because deep down I was afraid no one would ever love me.
That's just a short little clip, but I just like the dynamic and the way people can, like, a series like Mom can make you laugh at what the meetings are like, what recovery is like, how difficult it is and how fun it can be. And also, how recovery, there's life beyond addiction. These movies only show addiction, they don't show life after addiction. And I feel like shows like this are important. And as, like, you know, with canned laughter and sitcom-y vibe, like, at least something is representing that. So I just wanted to put, like, a tiny clip of that in this because I feel like it's super fun. And it's not the best show, but it's cool if you're in recovery and you're looking for something that you can really relate to, not something that glamorizes or makes you think of your past. Something that makes you think of the now, which is super cool, because just for today. I don't know why I lifted this like it's food. Just for today. Anyway, yeah, so.
It's for people to consume at their leisure.
Oh, this is true. This is true.
Visual consumption.
Okay, fine. Okay.
Eat this.
Eat, I don't know. This is going to be awkward. How are you going to edit this?